Okay, thank you very much for coming, everybody. I've already said that this morning, and I've already introduced you. I hope you found that the morning's presentations have been interesting and useful and relevant to you.
Yes, lots of new ideas to use in our work.
Excellent, good. Well, that's what we want to hear, thank you. Okay, so we come to the main event. David Crystal. We're delighted to welcome David Crystal. Very honoured that he would agree to come along. He needs absolutely no introduction, I'm sure, but I'm going to give him one anyway. David is one of the most respected authorities in the field of not just English, but I think it's true to say language in general. David has published more than 100 books, including the Cambridge Encyclopedia of Language and the Cambridge Encyclopedia of the English Language. His most recent publications include a little book of language, Begat, the King James Bible and the English Language, both published this year. And he is currently the consultant for the British Library Evolving English Exhibition, which runs until April 2011. And he was telling me beforehand that if you get the chance, do go. It's at the British Library, so you have to go to London, but well worth it if you get a chance. David is currently patron of AOTEFL and the Association for Language Learning, and is president of the UK National Literacy Association. In his spare time, he is honorary vice president of the Royal College of Speech and Language Therapists and the Institute of Linguists. He's been a member of the board of the British Council and of the English Speaking Union. He received an OBE for services to the English language in 1995 and was made a fellow of the British Academy in 2000. Roberta Facchinetti is our other very distinguished speaker, and thank you both for coming. Roberta is Professor of English Language and Linguistics at the University of Verona. Her research field and publications are mainly concerned with language description, textual analysis, and pragmatics, with specific reference to modality. She's also dealt with early modern English grammatical theory and lexicography, and has lectured on specialised languages and on teaching and research applications of corpora in a number of Italian universities. She has a special interest in language and the media, and the use of news-related texts in language study and teaching. And she is our sponsored speaker at TESOL this year. Earlier this year, Roberta and David co-edited a collection of papers along with Barbara Seidelhofer, From International to Local English and Back Again, which is a collection of papers considering the issues related to the processes of internationalization and localization of the English language. There are details of that publication in your packs if you're interested in following up on that. And international English is the subject of today's discussion. It's always seemed to me that there are a number of myths around English, and I'm sure David would say all language, and particularly here at the British Council, we have to deal with myths around what is British English. With the global spread of English and the dominance of English language, media and culture, it seems increasingly unlikely that students will be exposed to a single form of the language. So the question for language teachers is, what is the nature of the language that our students are exposed to, and what are they learning? So I'm going to ask Roberta to speak first, followed by David, and then there'll be plenty of time, I hope, for questions from the floor. Okay, so get thinking about it, while we're talking.
Start thinking. You can start asking questions immediately.
Well, number one, I have to thank you. I have to thank Kevin. I have to thank the British Council and all of the TESOL organisation for inviting me here. It's a great honour. It's a great pleasure. It's a great honour to be together with this big mentor of the English language and one of a number of other things. He's a workaholic, and I must say that I've tested that day and night.
It's better than being an alcoholic.
Much better, but it's a little bit troublesome for the people who work with you, obviously.
Have you heard the phrase internetaholic?
Internetaholic, you're also that way.
Recent.
You're also
going
to internetaholic. So he's a problematic person.
And blogaholic.
I didn't know you were that.
Yeah, I'm tweetaholic. That's the latest not one. Tweetaholics.
You're if you're not a Facebookaholic.
Facebookaholic. I haven't heard that one.
Anyway, now international English holics, he's definitely. And I would like to start with a quotation that is not from 2010, which is our year, but from 1956, so some time ago, from Firth. He said, "To begin with, English is an international language in the Commonwealth." So we are back in 1956. The colonies and the American. International is the sense that English serves the American way of life and might be called American. It serves the Indian way of life and has recently been declared an Indian language within the framework of a federal constitution. In another sense, it is international, not only in Europe, but in Asia and Africa, and serves various African ways of life and is increasingly the all-Asian language of politics. Secondly, and I say secondly advisedly, English is the key to what is described in a common cliché as the British way of life. So here, in this quotation from 1956, you've got an eminent person that everybody, I guess, knows if you have studied and dealt with the English language development, history and present day, saying that English, already at that time, was an international language. It started to be, in a way, an international language since, so to say, it started becoming the language of the colonies as well. So we have to go back not just to the 20th century but the 19th century and in a way the 17th century as well. But it's basically British English. This is the main point. Now I go back to another quotation, and this is from Daniel Davis, who is the president of the International Association of World Englishes. He pronounced this, he said this at the presidential address of this 15th annual meeting. It was just published. It was published in the Review of World Englishes. And he focuses again on international English, but mostly on world Englishes. So the shift is from international English to world Englishes, and mostly on the world inclusivity. And he says, "By inclusivity, I intend to characterize the point of view of the world English's approach. Inclusivity could be defined as the tendency to go beyond what is known, what is definite, and what is comfortable, to take into account different cultural and theoretical backgrounds, different points of view, different and even opposing values and arguments. In contrast to the in prefix contained in the word, it could involve breaking out of or suspending our language ideologies in order to recognize their counter and effect. It could be questioning assumptions and tentative conclusions on the basis of including new data. Inclusivity, as a principle, is based on something we do as linguists and, more importantly, as language users and language makers, and I would like to add, and language teachers as well." Now here you've got two people who know very well what they are saying and what they are writing, who basically focus on one thing, British English, and I would like to be a little bit provocative by saying that in Italy, British English is still the top variety being taught in Italian schools. We might add that American English is gaining ground, mostly because a good number of Italian teachers of English are going further off the borders, but most of all, we still have the top variety being spoken and written and taught as British English. And on the other hand, we also have the awareness that British English is not just the variety, but mostly that we have different kinds of Englishes. It is true that we have world Englishes, so here is the second pillar of our talk, and these world Englishes somehow enrich each other, because whenever you have some language contact, there is always creativity coming into place, and creativity in the positive sense of the word, because language contact implies adaptation. Language adaptation implies enrichment. Language enrichment implies, definitely requires creativity. But we also have what is this famous and phantomatic word somehow of international English. Do we mean international English by being the English spoken at an international level by almost everybody by now in different academic contexts? Or do we mean a different variety of English which is coming up? Is actually there something which may be called international English? Something which goes beyond borders, beyond varieties, and cut through cultures, and has a kind of lexicon and structure and morphosyntactic patterns which go beyond the single geographical and socio-historical varieties. I've got no answers so far because I'm waiting for David.
Not yet.
That's what I wanted to hear.
Not yet. You see, it's all happened so recently, hasn't it? First writing in 1956, nobody was talking about global English in those days. You know, international English, yes, and that had been a trend since, for over 100 years. People knew that English was an international language in the sense that it was a lingua franca, to choose an English expression. everybody was wanting to acquire, for a whole host of reasons, the political reasons that you mentioned. You mentioned the word colonies. Mm-hmm. Amazing, there was a time when we had colonies. Amazing, really. The scientific dimension, the fact that the Industrial Revolution was largely an English language experience. The economic developments of the 19th century, where money talks and the language it was talking was the pound and the dollar, mainly, during that century. And then the 20th century with all the cultural expansion that there was. Remember, 1956 is only 8 years after the formation of the United Nations. And why do you need a lingua franca when countries with different language backgrounds want to talk to each other? And the UN was the first real global experience where that had to happen. So they chose six official languages, but the main working language of the UN from the earliest days until now was, well, first of all, French and English, and now really predominantly English, much to the distaste of the French, of course, who wish it were the different. But English is now the main working language of the UN and the main working language of virtually any organization. And this has all happened in 50 years. Well, you know, 50 years is an eye blink in American English, and therefore one suspects all over the world. The continuous has been increasing in frequency and starting to be used in places where previously the simple form would have been used. And the perfect example is the one
McDonald's.
You see all over.
McDonald's, I'm loving it.
McDonald's, I'm loving it. I'm loving it. Where 40 years ago, it would undoubtedly have been, I love it. Okay? Now, I'm loving it. Would you have marked that right or wrong, you see, if a student had said or written that? Would you still? Well, you know, if you mark it wrong now and say this isn't very idiomatic or whatever, you're missing a trend. And it isn't just McDonald's, you see. The point is that there's been a 60% increase in the frequency of the present progressive over the past 40 years, according to these studies. And people are saying, you know, I'm remembering the point. Yes. I'm remembering the point. I remember the point, surely. I'm remembering it now, very clearly.
I think you're absolutely right, Dave. You might remember the it's actually taught in course books that there are verbs that you can't use in the continuous. Yes.
Emotional, sensual, and intellectual.
Especially these verbs, cognitive.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's right. Until you come across Otis Redding's "I've Been Loving You Too Long."
I've been thinking about you. So I kept on telling them, but at a certain point they stopped because there was this song. I've been thinking about you. So I said, okay, you better don't teach it anymore. Because they just
come back to you and say there's something wrong here.
Yeah, but it was in the present tense, you see, that the impact is most. When you're talking about past time and so on, the continuous has always been quite important. But in the present tense, you know, I am thinking, I am knowing, I am using, and that sort of thing, have always been rather marginal, rather special uses, apart from, in some regional varieties. In Indian English, for example, for nearly 200 years, they've been using the present continuous in that way. You know, I am thinking of what you're saying, I am knowing the answer to your question. You know, that sort of way of talking is absolutely normal there, and would not have been so normal in British or American English, but things are now changing. That's one example. And there are several others. Another one is the way in which certain modal auxiliaries are being replaced by, as it were, semi auxiliaries. And a good example is the switch from must to have to. In the old days, everybody, you must do this, you must do that, you must do the other. This no longer seems a good way of talking to people. People get a bit upset about it. You tell me I must do something. But whereas if you say something like, you have to do this, you have to do that, you have to do the other, people don't get upset. You know, it's a more relaxed way of instructing somebody. And again, must has been going down over the last 40 years, and have to has been going up over the last 40 years. And so there are lots of examples of this process of change taking place. And what it means is that, you know, the rule that you learn once upon a time, you have to be a bit tolerant about now. And while these examples, I hope, are very persuasive, there are some other areas which are more controversial. So, the plural of uncountable nouns, like information. You've got some informations for me.
News as well.
Yeah, I mean,
but information used to be right in the plural in the past.
Absolutely,
in the old English and Middle English.
You'll find information in Chaucer, and it went out in the 18th century because the prescriptive grammarians didn't like it, and that governed the way in which it was taught ever since. But there is a kind of natural tendency in people to say, if you've got several specific pieces of information, then you've got several informations to give somebody. So you will actually find informations as a plural increasing. Now, I would not yet recommend because the exam boards are notoriously conservative in this respect.
Lucky red but not blue.
But these are the things that are happening, you're absolutely right.
But this is a
wonderful discussion to moderate because it doesn't need any moderation at all. So just carrying on. But I said I would allow time for questions.
Sure.
So can I ask, does anybody have a question?
Maybe the change, the way people speak, reflects the change with the way people think. So 40 years ago, the principle of authority was more strong, and fathers told to daughters and
children,
what to do, and it was like a weight on the shoulder. Now people choose what they want to do, so I have to do something, not I must do something, can't and way of watching the world.
Yeah, that's the must example, I think, is indeed a reflection of a kind of psychological or cultural change that's taken place in society. Some of the other changes I don't think so easily represent a cultural change. You have to take each case on its merits, I think.
If I can't just say another thing. One looks information. Once upon a time, there was one kind of information, the Holy Bible. That was all. Now, everything has its own way of give a personal interpretation del mondo.
Interpretation of the
world.
Interpretation
of the world. Come dire?
World vision.
World vision.
Yeah.
World
vision.
I'd be careful here.
I'd be careful as well.
Yes,
not one information, but
No. This wouldn't hold up, because if you go back to the time of the Bibles, the 16th century, you will find that the plural of the word information was frequently being used at that time. You find it in Shakespeare, for example, and so on. So that would be taking the argument a little too far. I wouldn't overstress this point about change in language always reflecting a mindset change. Often a change in language takes place simply because of identity. That is, people want to be like somebody else. And a perfect example of this at the moment, which affects every one of you here, is I expect you spend an awful lot of time teaching your students to speak English in a nice, stress-timed way. Tum ti tum ti tum ti tum ti tum. And they are not to speak it in a syllable-timed way. Sort of way. And yet, you see, what is happening in English around the world, in global English, is an increasing amount of syllable timing because of the way in which the English spoken in places like the Caribbean and South Africa, most of Africa, in fact, and the subcontinent of India, is a syllable-timed English. If you hear an Indian person speaking English, it is syllable-timed. They say, the consequences of what I am saying are very important to you. Well, are you listening to me now as I try to speak in an Indian sort of way? It is ra-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta. You see, it's syllable-timed English, and there are 400 million people who speak like that. So you can't just dismiss it and say it's wrong. Or your young people will all have been impressed by rapping in English. And rap is Caribbean syllable-timed, you know? We're going to do a rap, so they are increasingly encountering a kind of rhythm that is not traditionally part of English. And once again, I think it means flexibility. Yes, one tries to teach stress timing because that is the norm for British and American English. But if a student is syllable timing their speech, maybe one is a little more relaxed about accepting it these days than one would have been a few years ago.
On the other hand, if I just can follow up and then you're free to comment. I also agree on what you said, because it is a fact that language changes because people change. So through the decades, through the centuries, since when the English language started, the variety of the different languages coming up, the different change in language was due, as usual in any language, to internal and external reasons. Not only external, so to say, because of language contact due to wars, due to borders, one close to the other, but also internal, because a certain number of people, maybe a small number of people, nobility or low-level people started speaking in that way, and then the change somehow spread over and over and over. So it is, there is some kind of bottom-down aspect.
It was exactly what I
said. You wanted to say. Yes.
Okay, over here.
Sorry, given that somebody might want to include world Englishes in their teaching or sensitize their students to this, has there been any reflection in the literature about what teaching method might
I don't know about the literature, probably very little, but certainly in terms of observation of practice and of excellence of practice, what one sees, at least what I've seen as I've travelled around the world looking at instances of this, is a kind of integration of the notion across the curriculum. The error would be to say, I will teach my students English, and then at an advanced stage, I will teach them about global varieties of English, which is, I think, the traditional way of looking at it. Better practice seems to be, I will teach my students English, and from day one of lesson one, you know, year one, I will also make them aware that whatever variety they are using, there are alternatives, so that they quickly learn the ethos of variation, and it becomes natural to them. They will expect difference, you know, and that's the fundamental change. Once upon a time, one was given the impression that you know, everybody speaks like I do, you see, and therefore that's the only kind of English you need to know. Whereas now, the ethos has to be, nobody speaks like you do, or hardly anybody. Remember, only 5% of the population of England actually speaks RP. So you're hardly ever going to encounter it as you go around the country. You'll hear it on the radio, of course, and so on, but you know, apart from any less there as before, as Roberta was saying. So I think practice around the world is showing that if you can do it drip, 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 an ethos of world English from the very beginning, this is a better solution than trying to sort of give it to them all in a huge mass at some later point.
But practice comes by knowing, so you can't choose if you don't know the different things among which you can choose. So basically you have to teach something first and then tell me, look, there are different possibilities. And then you can choose, but if you don't know the different things, then it's more difficult for the students, or virtually impossible for the students, to know which is which and which is better.
And remember,
we're
talking about production comprehension here too. So while you are teaching production in the kind of relatively conservative way that I was recommending a little while ago, so I think one has to be conservative in production, simply because the exam boards are conservative and so on. In terms of listening comprehension, the bets are off. You can do anything you like. When I learned foreign languages, the BBC used to do this a lot. They would do it exactly that way. I remember when I first started to learn German, using the BBC course, and lesson one taught me some basic bits of German for production and told me how to say them. And at the end of the program, they said, right, now we're going to go into a bar in this German city. Just listen. You won't understand any of it. Doesn't matter. Just listen. And I found that hugely illuminating, and actually I did understand the odd little bit here and there. I did that all the way through. You suddenly realise that your comprehension of German was greater than your production of German. Well, isn't that the truth for all languages? You know, your comprehension is always greater than your production. And so this is a way, actually, of fostering that kind of distinction.
Amanda had a question.
Thank you. Yes, two related questions. The same things are changing. Is this creating a richness of language, or is it creating a mess? And from that, a point of view of a teacher, what do we accept from our students, thinking of the Italian students? Where's the border between something that's right and wrong, or anything goes?
Well, anything goes is never a possibility with language. Never, 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 even though some prescriptive-minded people like to think that it is. No, there isn't randomness in any of this. Randomness occurs in language a very small proportion of the time. There is often in a sort of 1% of usage a kind of uncertainty about which direction the language is going. But the vast majority of rules that we have to encounter in language teaching, no problem at all. Remember, even all the variation we're talking about, when we talk about global English variation, nobody's ever tried to quantify it. But impressionistically, I would say it amounts to about 5% of the language. In other words, 95% of the rules of English are shared by all these global varieties of English. We don't know any variety of English that doesn't puts the definite article after the noun, for example, and the 3,000 or so other rules of word order in English are largely shared by all these varieties. Same with pronunciation, although there's a great deal of variation in pronunciation, the basic phonological system is 90% the same all over the place. And same for vocabulary. I mean, we've talked a lot. Vocabulary is always the area which manifests change most. And so we are impressed indeed by the fact that the Dictionary of South African English has 20,000 words in it that are not used outside of South Africa. But you say, that's a lot. But then you say, but there's 1.5 million words in English. What's 20,000 South African words going to do to us? You know, unless you actually need to go to South Africa or encounter a South African context, it's irrelevant. So you look at everyday English and you find that the vast majority of words in everyday English are shared by everybody around the English-speaking world. And so I don't think the problem is, although we're concentrating on it as a problem, I don't think it's actually as big a problem for the teacher as one might think. What do you think, Roberta?
Well, I was thinking about
if you put yourself in the shoes of a teacher, and a teacher has, for example, to teach, still thinking about modal verbs, the use of shall and will. I'm pretty sure that you already do what you are asking us to tell you in theory, because you already tell your students that up until the 30s or 40s or 50s, the use of the verb shall was particularly used in first person singular and plural, and that later on it changed, and that it's used at present basically in a relatively formal way for second and third in a completely different context, and rather than the first one. You already do that, and you don't tell your students, you have to say, I shall do this, I am, you will, we shall, and so on and so forth, because it's no longer the case. So I think the teachers already know the answer, and teachers already know what is the watershed between completeness and anything goes, and on the other hand, this may be acceptable, or this is no longer true. And the key to everything is that every single teacher always necessarily has to keep updated. You can just learn, study, finish your university career, maybe study a little bit more for your official examination and say, okay, I'm ready and that's it. Because we are in a continuous state of learning. We acquire every single day, because language changes every single day. We've seen that. So we can't say, this is the formula and this is what I'm going to teach my students for the rest of my career, because I'm dead already at the very beginning, on the very first day. So in any case, the answer is keeping updated, checking whatever is coming out with reference to publications, media, receiving, learning, listening, watching, anything which is truly English, and not necessarily British, so to say, but truly English, truly English. That gives you the answer to your question.
Okay. Teresa, did you have a question?
Yeah, I was just thinking, going back to vocabulary, one interesting aspect of lexical development is the distortion of words. So, for example, here in Italy, when they say mobbing, we say, what does that mean? Because it's an English word, mob is an English word that exists, but they've created a new meaning to the word in Italian. In the same way, for example, in English, we say al fresco, like al fresco dining, but here in Italy it means in prison.
This is perfectly normal, and your example is excellent, but what is wrong with what you said was the word distortion. Why do you think of it in that way? Why do you think of it? I know it's commonly, but this sort of thing is commonly said. What I see is a wonderful flowering of a new dialect of English called Italian English. Now, you're not unique here. When we talk about new Englishes around the world, we are not talking just about American English or South African English. We are talking about every kind of English: Indian English, Chinese English, Singaporean English, Swedish English, German English, French English, Italian English. Now, the notion of Italian English, traditionally, it always gets a bad press, because it's considered to be Italian speaking English badly, or Italian speaking English and messing it up in some way, or introducing some influence from Italian into English in some way.
And the other way around.
All the other way around, exactly. But the new way of looking at this, which is in evidence all over the world, is to see the development of a regional standard. You see, it takes a long time for it to happen. If a language becomes a global language, it is adopted by everybody, who then adapt it, as I said before. Who owns English now? No longer the British, no longer the Americans, no longer everybody. Anybody owns English who has chosen to use it. And slowly, over time, a country will evolve its own local usages. You've given an example here, but this is a very interesting exercise to do. Get a group of students together and ask them to write a dictionary of Italian, when they're using English, Italian influenced expressions that I would not understand coming here to Rome now, all right? Here's me coming to Rome, and we're having dinner together, and we're all using English, and we're talking about Rome. We're talking about Italy. And so in your English, you will now be using all kinds of expressions that I will not understand. I'll keep saying, what do you mean by that? What do you mean by that? What do you mean by that? You'll be talking about parts of the city with names that I don't understand. You'll be talking about your politicians with names I do not understand. You will have a huge vocabulary from Mr. Berlusconi. I will not understand any of it. I don't know what you call him in English, in private. And all of this... Just think of all the cultural identity of Italy that is expressed in your English when you are talking in English about your country. And I'm now sitting at the edge saying, what do you mean by that? What do you mean by that? What do you mean by that? Get a dictionary of that written and it will contain thousands, not just mobbing, you know, but thousands of lexical items, many proper names and things of that kind. Now this is forming the basis of a new English in Italy. It is of course spoken in an Italian accent, and what is wrong with that? It is a beautiful accent. There is no such thing any longer as one standard accent for the entire world. One should not be ashamed of speaking in an Italian way. There may be influences of Italian grammar, which wants interference from Italian, which doesn't cause any intelligibility problem for me any more than an American says to me, it's a quarter of, and I say, sorry, excuse me, it's a quarter to. I understand it. Somebody yesterday said to me, welcome in Italy. Fine, I don't have a problem with that. Welcome in is a very common locution all over the English-speaking world these days. It's not British English, it's not American English, but it's very common in world English. And these are, one should be proud of this sort of development and not condemn it or use a kind of negative phrasing. Again, I would not teach it because until such time as the whole examining system alters to reflect it, which will take a while. But certainly one must respect it.
And with reference to Italy, what I think is the level now in Italy is not that we are getting towards the birth of, or at least not yet, the birth of a new variety of Italian English, but rather Italian is flourishing more and more with the addition of English words. So it's Italian being enriched. This is the first level. We're still at the first stage. I'm not so sure that we can say that we're already getting into the situation of having a Italian English in the same way as you might have in other contexts where the English language is used more and more, also at an official level, also heard on TV and so on.
At a literary level, I think it's always the first step.
At a literary level, yes.
When a novelist or poet, an Italian novelist or poet or dramatist, decides to write a novel, poem or play in English reflecting Italian stories and backgrounds and characters and so on, that's the step at which you get a huge amount of local variation suddenly becoming part of the literary world. This has already happened, for example, in, say, Singapore, where there's a strong literature in Singaporean English now, and in Jamaica, where all the Jamaican poets, for example, write proudly certainly not British, certainly not American, you know, it's not like anything you've read, but it's a perfectly proud local variety. So they will come one day, but it's of course very early days in the case of Italy.
It's already there in songs.
Is it? Yes.
There are quite a lot of Italian singers who sing in English. Uh-huh. So they just basically translate from Italian into English and they develop their lyrics in English.
How interesting.
So this is a different thing, actually. But I fully agree.
I think we've got time for one more question, if anybody would have anything to ask.
Well, maybe in summary, do you think that we are in a transitory period where I think that today we've swung from that talking about standard English in certain contexts and so forth is kind of like the kiss of death, and on the other hand, we're almost worshiping what in reactionary language was substandard forms of English. For example, in the States, New Yorican, which, aside from being the language of a community, but it's also very, has been, you know, a lot of attention in Hollywood, so that a lot of the films coming out of the States and on television, if you have nothing to do with New York or the Puerto Rican community, your people in Kansas are beginning to get a knowledge of what distinguishes New Yorican from standard American English. In the teaching aspect, I remember 2 years ago I showed Slumdog Millionaire to in one of my classes of 16 and 17 year olds, and one of the students said, you know, Professore, che cosa è Chaiwala? And so I kind of went into about 5 minutes explaining that it's not, you know, a regular English, but it's part of one of the languages spoken in India. And but more than that, the important thing was the cultural item that that point of departure served to open a cultural window. Okay, and ironically, about 4, maybe 5 days later, one of the students from the class was angry with another student in the hall and saw me coming and said to him, said to the other student, "Be quiet, you chaiwala."
Yeah. Well, I think it's a good example. I would say that we are not worshipping. I think that's going too far. I know you're talking metaphorically there, but we are respecting. We are certainly in an egalitarian age. And the reason why we respect these varieties is because I think society has come to respect diversity and difference at a racial level. There are always exceptions, of course, and at a social level, at an ethnic level, shall we say, which didn't exist a generation ago. And language being the primary index of ethnic identity and cultural identity, it's, and the thing you notice most obviously, you can't see the person, you can hear the person, and you hear the language all the time. I think there is that kind of natural emphasis on language diversity as an index of that new point of view. But the even, remember what I said before, all of this diversity only amounts to about 5% of what's going on in everything they say. So a Slumdog Millionaire, you know, 95% of the English is exactly the same as what I'm saying now. So what am I saying now? Well, what you may not have noticed is that there's actually much more variation in my speech than you might expect. If you analyse me, did anybody notice, for example, at one point earlier on in my talk today, I said example, and at another point I said example? Probably not. I vary. I never know which is going to come out next. Am I going to say schedule, or am I going to say schedule? It will depend on who I'm talking to. If I'm talking to my children, all of whom say schedule, I will say schedule. Otherwise, I might say schedule. I don't know, nor do I care. That's the point. Nor do I care. It's not important. Now, a prescriptively minded person, I'd say, but you should care. You should care. I mean, you're letting standards go by being variable in this way. Well, I don't agree. I don't agree. There's nothing wrong with a bit of variety. There are two points of view in life. You can be dogmatic, you can be pragmatic. I don't like being dogmatic. I love being pragmatic. A dogmatic person wants me to dress the same way every day, wants me to behave in the same way in all circumstances. A pragmatic person likes to vary their behavior depending upon circumstances. It's the same with language. So you're not going to please everybody by adopting a pragmatic perspective in relation to language use, but at least you will reflect a reality that I think the students are increasingly likely to encounter.
And the reality is actually that Derek Crystal is a living example of a pragmatic, egalitarian person, because English as well is a very, shows to be a very egalitarian language, but simply by adapting to the different ethnical contexts, the different multicultural situations. It's a matter of adaptation, which, as I said at the beginning, is a matter of gradual and mutual cultural richness. Mm-hmm. And let me conclude, because we started up with a quotation, and I would like to conclude with a quotation, which is a quotation very useful for teachers, because it comes from the European English Framework.
dealing with the Council of Europe when they set out the different levels, the six different levels of competence of English, gave the different objectives. And one of the objectives is exactly what you were saying, David, to build up mutual understanding and acceptance of cultural and linguistic diversity in a multilingual and multicultural context, which is actually what we have acknowledged that the English language is doing now and has been doing through the centuries. Gradual adaptation, gradual meeting of different worlds, so to say, in a very profitable way, as far as I could understand. So thank you.
Very much in line with the mission of the British Council. Thank you very much to both.
Thanks.